irony for me talking about safety this week. I'm kind of sporting the results of not being particularly safe. So after the last talk, I've reflected, and I can just give everybody a tip not to run in the dark, or at least not to fall over while running in the dark. Okay, so yeah, see that. Okay, so thanks very much, Russell. Thanks for the invitation. It's a real pleasure to be here and see this this conference, this symposium, and a really widespread of people from across lots of disciplines here. So I'm going to talk a bit today about surgical graspers and the work that we've been doing around surgical graspers and how they interact with tissues, and I guess in particular their relation to safety or surgical safety. So yeah, I'm an engineer, which sounds like a bit of an admission, but we have a surgical technologies research group within mechanical engineering, but has strong links to psychology, long-running links with Mark and Fessel, and also to the clinical side of things over at St James's, over at the hospitals. So we're keen to kind of make links and make sure this is multidisciplinary work. So the, I guess the start of this work came from this clinical, looking at this clinical drive. I think this is going to be familiar to a lot of you, but I've used these slides as a nice introduction, I think, to the kind of the progress of surgery and this real drive to reduce patient trauma. I suppose initially it was to reduce patient mortality, really, you know, to prevent people from dying when they underwent surgery. So things like the introduction of anaesthesia obviously made it a bit more acceptable to patients. And then a real step change occurred with the introduction of laparoscopic surgery. So in particular operations where you need to access internal organs within the body, rather than having open surgery where you have to open somebody up, large incision, expose them to possible infection risks. So I'm just going to switch the timing off. Otherwise it's going to keep going through. There we go. That's better. So this has a real impact in terms of patient benefit. So it reduces patient trauma and improves the situation for the patient because it minimizes the incisions that need to be made in the abdominal wall. It reduces the exposure to infection risks. And generally, the hospital stay after an operation done laparoscopically compared to open surgery is much, much shorter. So recovery time is improved. You don't have the associated risk of, I guess, infections within the hospital as you recover. So it's seen as a big step change in surgery. And then, sort of latterly, I suppose is interesting to us as engineers, the introduction of robotically assisted laparoscopic surgery. It's kind of touted as being highly precise. You can see the surgeon sits at a games console type situation, and they're able to manipulate remotely instruments which interact with the tissues inside the body. It gives them the opportunity to have levels of dexterity that they wouldn't have in standard laparoscopic surgery. So the Da Vinci robot is currently the only commercially available system. That's about to change, but essentially you have a system which looks a little bit like conventional laparoscopic surgery, except you have a wrist joint on each of the tools, so you're able to do more dexterous manipulation. The surgeon is also able to really kind of finely control those tools because it can scale the movement from their hands down to the surgical manipulators. So a large movement of the surgeon's hands can be mapped down to a much smaller movement of the tools, so you're able to do very precise, delicate manipulations. So again, touted as having benefits for the patient. It's kind of an arguable one that I think it took a long time to find a home. It was originally kind of introduced for wartime, or as a wartime system, because you can do this remotely. The surgeon can sit somewhere completely different to the patient. Then it was introduced, and it kind of looked for a niche. And the surgeons that we work with use it in colorectal surgery, where it has a real kind of benefit, because the surgery takes quite a long time. It's quite difficult to access those regions, particularly down in the pelvis. So something like the Da Vinci gives them the opportunity and the dexterity they need to do those operations, and prostate surgery as well. It's kind of seen as a real advantage. So the result of this kind of innovation, or this this move from open all the way through to laparoscopic and robotically assisted laparoscopic surgery, is you having different tools that interact with the tissues. So it used to be in open surgery that the surgeon can directly touch and feel the tissues that they need to interact with. They can directly see them as well, which is quite an interesting angle. They obviously use tools as well, like forceps, scissors and things like that to cut tissues, but they can actually directly touch and manipulate the tissues. You then move to laparoscopic surgery, and you have a situation where the tools that are interacting with the tissue go through the ports, and those tools are on a long shaft, so you have things like friction, which act to kind of interfere with the sense of touch that you have as a surgeon. So you're interacting with the tissue remotely, essentially, through this tool. You'll get some indication of the kind of the resistance of the tissue at the end of that instrument, but it's going to be disturbed by all the mechanical losses down the shaft of the instrument, and the fact that you've got all these different lever arms. So you can imagine it's quite difficult to precisely sense what's going on at the tissue end from this scissor grip handle at the outside the body. And you also remotely, you also lose the direct vision. So you have to use a laparoscope, so a camera inserted into the abdominal cavity to look at the tissues that they're interacting with. So they lose direct vision and they lose direct touch. So that's two quite important senses that are being interfered with. But we're still asking these surgeons to operate and manipulate delicate tissues inside the body. And then if you look all the way through to something like the Da Vinci, you have the precision of movement, as in the actual kinematics, so you can move very, very finely, but there is absolutely no haptic feedback there at all. So the robot has no way of communicating the force with which it grips the tissues back to the person using that system. So the grip force, when you command it to close its grasp or hold a piece of tissue, is entirely up to the Da Vinci. So it has preset thresholds, but there's no way that you can know other than by sight. So you might kind of infer from the deformation of the tissues how hard you're grasping. It's quite difficult to map that back to, you know, some tangible sense of how hard that is and if it might be damaging the tissue. So we can sort of generally summarise this as improvements in terms of access. So there's definitely lower trauma access to the surgical site with laparoscopic and robotically assisted laparoscopic surgery. Improvements in the manipulation of tissues with respect to positioning, but definitely not with respect to the ability to sense the touch, the haptic interaction with those tissues. So that's the kind of the angle that we're coming at this from. So is there any ways, as engineers, we like to kind of instrument things, we like to measure things, understand things, what could we do to improve the situation? What could we do to look at tissue-respecting instruments? Could we apply our skills to have some benefits there? So generally, we'd like to look at how we can reduce tissue trauma, how we can look at improving surgery in general by improving outcomes. So as engineers, we need to understand the problem. So we need to understand, first of all, what causes trauma or tissue trauma. So we know that if you hold a piece of tissue, you've all had bruises before. I'm sporting one at the moment. If you hold a piece of tissue too tightly, then you risk bruising that piece of tissue. So if it's external, it might just be unsightly. If it's internal to the body, then you may impair the function of a particular organ or piece of tissue. If you do that to excess, then you may do things like perforate. So things like colorectal surgery, if you grasp the colon too tightly, you risk perforating the bowel, which is a really, really catastrophic situation for the patient, because obviously the contents of the bowel can then leak out into the abdominal cavity, and you really risk kind of the patient's safety. But more kind of, or less extreme than that, if you bruise the tissues of the colon, if you hold it what you think is in a delicate manner, but you may still impair the function of that tissue. So it's really, really critical that we understand this process. And that can lead on to improved instrument design. So if we start to know how this kind of damage occurs, how the trauma occurs, then we can, by measuring the process, then we can look at how we can improve instrument design. So there's some interesting work that's gone on in this area before around the world, and essentially it comes down to trying to map out or define what is safe and this is a fairly woolly kind of subject. I think in particular because it's going to vary from tissue to tissue, some tissues are more robust than others. But if we look at the situation in terms of colorectal surgery, the risks of not being safe, as I mentioned, are post-op bias, so really losing the function of that organ for extended periods of time, risking adhesions, and loss of the gut barrier. So people have proposed a situation like this, where you have, we all love a graph, so you can try and simulate what you mean by safe. So we imagine that there's some threshold pressure beyond which you're going to damage the tissue. So if we just look at this in terms of the force or the pressure that which you exert on the tissue, at some point you exceed a particular nominal pressure and you're going to start to damage the tissue. The risk in terms of grasping in a surgical scenario is if you don't grasp hard enough, then you may slip. So you really don't want to slip as a surgeon. You don't want to kind of risk things, tissue slipping out of your graspers. Equally, you don't want to grasp too hard and cause damage. This is compounded then by the effects of time, possibly. This is our hypothesis, that what might be a safe grip for a short space of time, if you extend that period of time, might become unsafe. So you have to be careful about the length of time you grasp the tissue for, as well as the amount of pressure that you exert on that tissue. So this is some work, and it links to some work at various research institutions, and we were kind of looking to explore this with our own studies. The way we're going to go about doing that was, first of all, an experimental investigation to understand what do surgeons actually apply? What kind of forces do they apply? How do they use these tools? So once we can do that, we can move on to modelling that or trying to simulate that process in more controlled settings in our own lab. And then also we kind of realise that it's all very well to do this on pieces of tissue ex vivo. We need to have some way of trying to correlate what we understand mechanically with clinical measures that make sense to clinicians, and make sense in terms of the actual structure of the tissue. So that was our kind of approach, to first of all understand what clinical practice is like, and then try and simulate it, and then look through to some correlation with the clinical practice. So first of all, we did some work, and we built some instrumented graspers. As I said, we all like building kit and engineering, so we jumped at the chance to kind of develop our bespoke surgical graspers. And essentially all we did was made a little housing that went in between the handle and the shaft of a pair of laparoscopic graspers, and that was able to measure the position of the shaft of the graspers so we could tell if they were opening or closing, and it also had a load cell in so we could tell how much force was being applied down the shaft to close the grasper jaws. And in doing so, then we gave the surgeon a tool that they were kind of familiar with. It didn't look too different. And we asked a range of surgeons and surgical trainees as well, so people at different stages of training, to use this tool. We had one for each hand in a box trainer situation. And we had a couple of scenarios that we asked them to run through. Here, what you should be able to see is... is a procedure simulating running a bowel, so just inspecting the bowel, kind of going from one hand to another hand, taking this piece of tissue, so this is some porcine colon that we put in the box trainer, and the surgeon's going from one hand and just going and just running through it. So essentially in clinical practice this would be to check for abnormalities or to look for a particular location on the piece of tissue. So what we're interested in here is how tightly did they grasp that piece of tissue. How repeatable was it? What kind of forces were they going to? What kind of forces and how quickly were they applying them? It was really interesting, this study. It took a long time to try and get the numbers up. We had about six in each group here, and that was really difficult with the consultants in particular. So we had to go off the back of various kind of surgical events, just descend with our box trainer and rope people into doing these particular trials. But we got six people in each group, and this was just our kind of preliminary study, what kind of things occur in surgical practice. So you can see some example data. It's nothing that surprising here. So this is a trace from the grasper. So over time, you can see as the surgeon grasps and then releases the tissue, you have a spike in force, and then that force dips a bit and is maintained while they're manipulating the piece of tissue. And then you can see as they release it in between, and then the next grasp occurs. And so we looked at sort of drawing some metrics from this, in particular looking at the maximum force and the RMS force that was delivered to that piece of tissue. I think we were expecting from this study to find some huge differences between groups. In actual fact, it turns out, from our data at least, and it's a small data set admittedly, but the one thing you can sort of say and characterise this as is that there was quite a lot of uniformity between groups, in particular running the bowel, but that less experienced trainees, there was a lot more variability. So it was the variability that was the kind of the thing that characterised the different levels of training, but there wasn't huge differences in the force used between groups. So it was quite an interesting one to us. I guess we'd expected maybe the consultants to be very precise and use lower forces. In actual fact, it might be that they know exactly the force they want to go in with, and they're very direct with that. It's difficult to tell exactly what their intention is, but we had some nominal figures to work with here. But it wasn't quite the striking kind of change that we might have expected. So I guess the other reflection on this is that it's maybe very difficult to regulate that amount of force. So another test that we did was looking at this maximum force that you would perceive to be allowed to apply to the tissue. So if I said to you, can you apply as much force as you think is safe to that piece of tissue? That's what we asked the surgeons and the trainees to do. And you can see that the at the CT level, those were slightly higher, but statistically it's not massively different. And so we felt that there was generally a case that it's very difficult to regulate the forces applied and difficult to know exactly how much is safe for a particular type of tissue. So we took that information and we went to the lab and we looked to develop a simulation of surgical grasping in the lab setting. So we built up our own equipment and we simplified the system. So surgical graspers have a scissor action, which means that the pressure distribution across the jaws, as you kind of close the jaws like that, is higher near the pivot point compared to the distal end of the jaw. So we simplified things a little and had essentially a parallel plate grasper mechanism. But the thing that we could do with that is measure directly the pressure, which is uniform across that face, applied to a piece of tissue. And we could vary that parametrically. So we used porcine colon again, and essentially replicated grasping, three different speeds, and a range of different pressures, going from a fairly low pressure to pressures that have been quoted in the literature as being kind of critical for tissues. And we did this procedure where we had this indentation phase, or the grasping phase. So you apply the pressure up to a particular maximum pressure, then you stop the grasper jaws there. So it's like you've grasped, and then you've held. And then as you hold, we hold between, it says 5 to 60 seconds here. We refine this protocol down to just a 10 second grasp. And then we release the tissue, and we then repeated these. So we did repeat grasps on the same piece of tissue to simulate the same piece of tissue being grasped many times. And we did this for a range of pressures, as I said. And the results that we got out from this were really interesting. Essentially what we're looking to do, first of all, to see how the tissue behaves, but then from the behaviour of the tissue, see if we can identify a way to alert the surgeon and to detect in real time if trauma is occurring. So we knew from the relaxation phase here, you can see in this hold region here, if you grasp a piece of tissue, it behaves in a viscoelastic way, so it behaves fluidly, if you like. So the tissue, once it's been grasped, starts to relax a bit, and you see the force drop off. And we can look at that drop off, and we can understand how well it's recovering, essentially. So if you see very little recovery, you see very little drop off, then the tissue is very compressed, and it's not doing very well, essentially, so it's more likely to be damaged. That's all well and good, but if you're looking to use that as a predictive measure, it's not particularly useful because you've already done the damage. The damage has been incurred. So we started to look at this grasping region here, this first region, this is when the pressure is being applied to the tissue. So if you can identify some characteristics in this region to alert you to the fact that the trauma is occurring, then you can actually stop before you do any damage or significant damage to the tissue. And after a lot of kind of processing the data, playing with different techniques, we found that we could identify something we've called the normalized stress rate as being something that we thought predicted the onset of trauma. So it sounds like a very convoluted term, not particularly easy to kind of get your head around. Essentially what it means is that during this grasping phase, as you grasp the tissue harder and harder, the tissue starts to stiffen, so it resists that compression. So as that increases, essentially the faster it increases, the more likely you are to incur damage. And the reason we normalize it with respect to the grasping rate is because this is like fluid tissue. So within the tissue, there's lots of fluids, and they react to the faster you move, the more they react to resist that movement. But if you account for that by normalizing with the rate at which you compress them, you can actually detect from this this metric how the tissue stiffens, does give you some prediction about the trauma that's going to occur. So you can see here the ranges of different pressures, critical pressures. Here's the lowest pressure. If you just look at this first line, you can see that there's a trend. As we increase pressure, the stress rate, the normalized stress rate, ramps up. And it essentially comes to this sort of plateauing effect. So it ramps up and it plateaus. You can also see in the graph that if we look at extended cycle numbers, so we're repeating the grasps one after another, even for light grasps, you can see that that piece of tissue eventually starts to plateau. We believe this is when the tissue is becoming damaged as it plateaus. And you can actually see there's some overlap. So the interesting thing here is that if you repeatedly grasp something with a light touch, you may have the same effect as grasping it with a much higher grasp, but for just one touch. So the implications for the surgeon are that you have to be careful about repeatedly grasping the same area of tissue, as well as the actual absolute value of pressure that you apply. Yeah, sure. Yes. Yes, we did. So, no, it's fine. Yeah, because the real challenge that we had in this study was we've kind of made inferences from the mechanical data or the mechanical measures that we've got, looking at the compression and the deformation of the tissue, and to an extent we've had to say that the deformation of the tissue is a proxy for damage, for trauma. But what we wanted to do is to relate that to the clinical measures. So yeah, these are the histology. We've got the histology. Histological analysis for all the samples that we looked at, all the different pressure levels. So you can see these characterized here. So we went from 50 kilopascals all the way through to 300 kilopascals. And it's really evident here, you can actually see the tooth marks in the tissue. So you can really clearly see the definition of the grasp of teeth in the tissue, and how it impacted and squashed the different layers. And it's less so, you know, clearly at sort of low pressure levels at 50 kilopascals. This is for a single indentation, by the way. There's very little trace there. But as you ramp up, we saw more and more evidence of damage and more compression of the tissue layers. So this was really encouraging for us because it starts to give us a way to link the mechanical measures to the histology, something that's kind of clinically relevant. So when we summarised that, what we did was, if I just flip back, we looked at each of these kind of indentation sites, so where the point of the tooth is bitten, we had to take a measure of the constitutive layers of the tissue at those points. And we did that across a number of points for each sample that we had. So that gives us this data set here. So you can see you're grasping on the outside of the tissue, but you can see the extent, you can see the effect that it has on the different layers of tissue. So the tissue that we grasped was a ring piece of colon, So inside the colon is the mucosal lining, and on the outside is where we graft. And the outside is actually where you see the change, the deformation, the key deformation. So in these two outer layers here, that's where the majority of the deformation occurs, because that's where the teeth are directly kind of interfering and biting into. And if we looked then at the mean reduction, essentially, in here is the total tissue thickness. You can see a strong correlation between our normalized stress rate, which we can make in real time from our mechanical measures, and then this reduction or this deformation in the tissue thickness. So this was essentially our proxy measure for trauma in the tissue or for damage. But we were kind of convinced here that there is a trend, a strong trend, with this stress rate, normalised stress rate, and trauma that's occurring in the tissue. So the limitations of this work are really that our histology gives us some way or some indication of the trauma that's occurring. Really, the next step in this kind of work is looking at some in vivo studies and looking at the inflammatory response of the tissues. So at the moment, we can't say for sure exactly how the tissue is damaged. We're looking for mechanical structural changes, essentially. But we know that inflammatory response will kind of be evident at fairly low pressure levels, and that will give us a real idea about how the tissue is being damaged. So follow-on studies from this would look to do in vivo studies, grasping at different pressures, and then looking at the inflammatory response. So, just in conclusion, I think this work has been kind of a lot of basic science, but there's definitely implications across the board in terms of, clinically, I think, the training.
Until it releases from the tissue.
We might want to mute that. Let's see if I can turn
that on. Like that. And release it when they...
And you're
from here.
I'll pause it there. Then you see a surgical simulator, a speaking surgical simulator. But it has relevance to surgical training, I think, because at the moment we're all about dexterity, but it's difficult to have any informed kind of measures of how hard you should grip tissues at the moment. So this kind of work can feed into that kind of improvement in training. And also inform clinical practice, so things like how hard and how fast should you grasp tissues. And ultimately, we hope it will lead to improvements in instrumentation as well. So if there's ways that we can design instruments to have sensors embedded within them, which Dom's talked to you about before, we can maybe provide the surgeon with haptic feedback and indications of if they're exceeding a particular pressure threshold. As an academic pursuit, I think it's really fascinating to work in this area. It's highly multidisciplinary, and I think it does genuinely complement the kind of work that's been undertaken in industry. So obviously industry and the people who develop these surgical graspers, it's hard to compete with their R&D budgets, but I think we're doing work that kind of complements that rather than competes with it, so it has real value. Okay, and with that, I'll pause it again. Okay, I'd just like to say this is very much a team effort, so I've said we, and use the royal we a lot, so there's a huge number of people here, and there's probably more that I've missed off, but yeah, a big thanks to the team, and I don't invite any questions.